Well, obviously we like to think we're unique in many respects. There are facilities of somewhat similar at some of the major universities in the country, but I think certainly in the upper Midwest there's nothing comparable.
We've had over 500,000 people so far attend events.
Well, in the case of the symphony, it's especially far-reaching. We have a large number from Minneapolis, Omaha, Lincoln, Kansas City, every concert, because where else could you hear these great orchestras?
When you opened the auditorium to get a big attraction, you brought in the New York Philharmonic. How did that work out?
Well, that worked out very successfully, Russ, as everyone that attended feels, I believe. And it encouraged us to pursue the idea of possibly doing the same thing another year with another great world symphony, which we did in bringing the Philharmonic, the Philadelphia Orchestra in the next season.
Did the success of the New York Orchestra have anything to do with making it easier to get other large symphonies here?
That's a good question, Russ. It really did. And the good time that they had out here when they, in many cases, really expected to be sort of bored, the time that we showed them out here in the Midwest, the hospitality and the extra tours to farms and the amenities and little services and courtesies and entertained by our community surprised them, and the week was gone in a hurry where some of them, I think, wondered what they would do all week in Ames.
In the case of those from New York and then the next year from Philadelphia, was this the first time many had been out in this part of the country?
Well, I think most of us that go back east once in a while are a little bit surprised at how little they seem to know about our part of the country. I think this isn't as bad as it used to be, but a great many of them were surprised at what they found out here. Well, the biggest factor is this fine facility, Russ. The perfect acoustics of this auditorium, the nice size of it, and then the Midwestern audiences please the greatest artists because of their warmth and obvious appreciation of the programs that they give. And they're all human under the skin and feeling this sort of thing, just like all of us.
I understand that word of this facility and of these audiences spreads through the music world.
Well, it certainly does. Next year, we are having the London Symphony Orchestra for our festival for a week under Andre Previn. And the management of the New York Philharmonic offered to call their friends of the London and recommend that by all means don't miss the chance to take this trip out here. They'd have a wonderful time. We thought that was quite an eloquent testimonial. Well, in this case, Fiedler, who is a great institution and part of the Boston Symphony Orchestra, set up together with the 100-and-some men at practically the same personnel that comprise the Boston Pops during the summer season, are all here, and we're doing a Boston Pops concert, as everyone seems to know, judging by the orders we've had to turn away.
Have you actually had to turn down orders?
Oh, hundreds, really thousands, I guess, literally, for the Pops. The other series, of course, there are four of these, and there are a few seats left yet for these, and they are still available. With Eileen Farrell as a soloist opening night, and Francis Scotti, the great violinist, another, Malcolm Frager, pianist, another, and our own oratorio chorus with soloists doing the Brahms Requiem on Sunday afternoon.
we have here many, many lectures for the campus itself and for the community. We have a great deal of meetings. We have church meetings. In fact, you name it, and we have it right here as just a general source of place to have events, you know.
Of course, people see the sellout crowds for basketball games or for concerts. They think this must be making a lot of money.
Yes, but this is not always the case, because on many, many of these small events that we have here, the charges that we have to give here as part of our general billing procedures won't always cover the expenses. So in this particular instance, why, the university assumes part of the underwriting for the events.
In other words, you don't only book to see if you can make profit.
No, we try to book to make these things available to our population here.
Well, the little theater will house student plays, recitals, dance programs, lectures for relatively small audiences. The little theater will seat 424. The continuing education building will be the focal point for our extension and short course activities. Thousands of adults who come from all over the country, really, to utilize the expertise of our faculty in professional meetings.
What was the cost of building that?
Well, the Stephens Auditorium is $5 million, all from contributions. The Hilton Coliseum is $7.85 million, basically paid by bonds backed by student fees. Now we're about to start the third building of the center, the Little Theater. This is $900,000, and this is all in hand from contributions. And then the fourth and final building of the center is the Continuing Education Building, which is, best we can estimate, about $5 million, again, all from contributions. So it's a total of about $18.5 million. We have contributions from more than 12,000 individuals and organizations from actually in different parts of the world.
And outside the United States?
Oh, yes. We have regular donors in Australia, Africa, Europe, and practically any country in the world.